Okay, well, thank you for going for the podcast. What's up, Mainframe?
Yes.
It's great to hang you.
Yes.
I have some questions for you.
Welcome to another episode of What's Up Mainframe. I have another very interesting guest today on the show, Vaughn Marshall. Vaughn, welcome.
Thank you.
We don't know each other very well, do we?
Not at all.
Yeah. He's the product manager, I'm the product owner, but we're all in product management.
Yes, we're products.
Let's hear a little bit about where Vaughn's come from and what he's working on and kind of leading right now.
Vaughn? All right, sure. So let's see, my background. I started my career in Mainframe. I was actually in QA, did some development, did QA.
Okay.
And then my company actually had moved me over to SCM. So okay. Started... you know, just that was where I kind of first got into the world of software configuration management, process automation, developer processes, and things like that. And I actually took a, I guess I was out of Mainframe for a while.
Okay.
So I was helping people implement different types of version control. Back in those days, there was more than just Git.
Indeed.
Yeah. So, I did that for a couple of companies, and then I went into consulting. So I was a consultant and traveled around to, you know, Fortune 500 companies all around the world, actually under CAs. So back then, CA Technology. So I was working at a CA partner.
Okay.
And eventually that partner got acquired by CA Technologies. And I started working in the DevOps value stream where I was reacquainted with Mainframe.
Indeed.
You know, it was actually serendipitous, because I think one of the strengths that I have is I've seen both sides of the world.
Certainly.
And I have no ill perception of Mainframe, having worked there, you know, so no misconceptions. A lot of people in the distributed world think old, you know, Mainframe, old technology has
completely different from what we do.
I, of course, was more enlightened than that. So. I was quite happy to be back in Mainframe. And as a matter of fact, one of the things I noticed coming back to the world of Mainframe is how awesome the community is, because it is a kind of a smaller world. You meet the same people at the conferences and things like that. So I actually quite enjoy it. And through my journey from product owner, I ended up moving into product management and became the product manager for Endevor. And that's where I am now. And you know, I'm using my skills to kind of help bring Endevor to the world of, you know, next gen development, next gen tools. You know, that's basically it.
Definitely. And there's actually an interesting point, I would say, just because I remember when I joined CA, but you were kind of leading a project which was very much about integrations between distributed world and Mainframe.
Yes.
And that was kind of an early flavor of some of the solutions we work on today.
Yep, absolutely. So integration is that, in fact, I mean, if you think about DevOps and where the way it started, before DevOps was kind of the word people used, they would call it application lifecycle management. And the approach back then was, you know, you need to use all one platform and everything integrates. And then that kind of fell out of favor, and people were building new infrastructures based on heterogeneous tool sets.
Yes.
So that's kind of what we were doing. Now we're kind of coming full circle in a way. Everything is almost integrating around Git. There's flavors of Git, but it's always Git, right? So it's matured quite a bit. The terms have changed, but a lot of the concepts are the same. But integration, you know, the handoffs between what a developer does to what a tester does to what a, you know, somebody who's trying to release something, and building the automation through those handoffs.
Yep.
That's pretty much what we've been working on, and making that relevant in the world of Mainframe.
Certainly.
Of course, saying that, you know, a lot of what we're talking about has been in Mainframe forever. Right. Now, it's a little bit different now. Back in the days of the early days of DevOps. By the way, I don't know if you know Endevor is an acronym.
We went through acronyms in one of the earlier episodes with Lukash. Endevor.
Endevor indeed. Stands for Environment for development and operations. And if you think that sounds like DevOps, you are right.
Yes.
In any case, we've had DevOps practices in the world of Endevor and Mainframe for many, many years, but the difference was it was typically all on one machine.
Yes.
Now, activities are spread across lots of machines. You'll have somebody doing something on an enterprise Git server, they'll be running their editors on their laptop, maybe in an IDE like VS Code, then there'll be a CI server, a CD server, and so it's gotten more complex, but certainly the goals are kind of the same. Handoffs are automated,
yes.
Processes are automated, safeguards are put in place as you do the handoffs, so you want to make sure that things like your static analysis runs automatically, and that you, in doing so, can prove that you haven't introduced new technical debt or some bug or something along those lines.
Yeah. So, one of the things that really came out. So Vaughn is here as part of the Mainframe Technical Institute in Prague, and there were a lot of
what
sessions
a good time.
About indeed,
<Yes.
laughs> in more ways than one. A lot of the sessions were about, you know, where you can really take your organization with the range of our solutions.
Mm-hmm.
But to be honest, if you go into some of those sessions and you hear about this automation with pipelines, Git, VS Code, it sounds a bit daunting,
mm-hmm.
right? It doesn't sound like something that a lot of folks can readily go to in just a matter of days.
Mm-hmm.
So can you talk about some of the paths or some of the steps that you've seen customers take to kind of explore, play with, and then actually put into production even?
Definitely it can be a bit daunting. And in fact, if you take the approach that you're going to boil the ocean, it's going to be daunting.
Yeah.
Success, I think, when you're talking about transformation like that, is best done in small steps. Mm-hmm. So, I am seeing a pattern emerging with our customers. So obviously the bulk of them start in Endevor. They've been, in fact, they have automation for quite a number of the things that you would typically do, the deploys, the builds, et cetera, that's been in place for 30, 40 years and works well. Okay, so, if for instance, you wanted to introduce a new generation of developer to being able to develop with a tool set like Git that they know, rather than having the learning curve of green screens, if you take the approach that you're just going to do a lift and shift, you're going to have a lot of rewriting to do.
A lot of rewriting. You're going to alienate a bunch of people.
You're going to alienate a bunch of people. You're going to have to do a lot of rewriting, and you're going to take on a ton of risk, right? And in the end, you won't have gotten too far. You've maybe made a small community of next gens happy at the expense of, the bulk of your developers that are still in the traditional world. So what we recommend is a different approach. And essentially it starts with essentially reusing what you have in Endevor. There are new processes in the world of DevOps. So the source code scanning I mentioned, there's source code scanning tools that work with mainframe code. None of them run on mainframe.
Nope.
There might be something, TCL check one, you could argue, but let's say a sonar cube, you want to use the COBOL scanner. So you need to get the code to the sonar scanning machine, which is not on the mainframe. So there's this hybrid world that you need to enable for things like that. But the real challenge is the culture change, and is there a way to do that type of thing without forcing everybody or moving everything or reinventing all your build automation just because you want to have source code scanning, et cetera. Yeah. So the pattern that we're seeing is that customers will start off by putting up our web services,
okay,
which essentially opens up what's running on the mainframe to the rest of the computing infrastructure in your organization through REST API.
Yep.
And then you have any number of ways that you can do work. So let's say your first use case, remember, starting in small steps.
Yes.
If your first use case is, hey, we've got next gen developers that don't want to work in the green screen, right? They could, for instance, just use an IDE talking to the web services. So you're the product owner of Explorer for Endevor. I'm sure you are familiar with that capability.
Covered that in one of the previous episodes.
Yep. So basically, you know, what's nice about that approach is you're not reinventing your builds. You're not reinventing your deploy. You've got the capability to give an interface that's friendly to next gens. And by the way, I keep saying next gens, but you know, I'm also aware of quite a number of traditional mainframe developers that use VS Code for certain things. Yes. You know, maybe code reviews, etc. There's just some things that a scroll bar really helps with.
Certainly.
Right? Yeah. I mean, but they may not use it for everything, or maybe they use it for everything. I mean, but the point is nobody's telling them that they have to change.
Yeah.
It's up to them, because they can continue to work in the ISPF panels in Endevor the way they always have.
And that's very much a case with teams inside Broadcom here.
Yep,
right?
Absolutely.
They have to, they're working on their source code. It's in Endevor.
Yeah.
They're really fast in the green screen.
One of the things I like about Broadcom is that, you know, our teams, keep us accountable. So there's nobody just going, you have to use these tools. If I want, you know, Broadcom teams to use Endevor tools, they better be good, because they get the choice, just like everybody else, to use them or not use them. So
yeah,
they're some of our toughest customers.
They really are. Talk about strong comments in various chat channels. Hey, this, this is not doing what I need.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, okay, so that's one use case. Another use case might be the source code scanning use case. So we have another tool that, what do you know, you're also the product owner for, called Bridge for Git. And that tool lets you synchronize what's in Endevor with a Git repository, meaning you could have somebody make a change in the ISPF panels in Endevor. Their change synchronizes to Git, and that kicks off a scan. Yep. You could also use that to make the change in Git in the first place. The product reconciles the two workflows.
Yes.
But again, you're not forcing anyone to change.
Yeah.
But that also said, at some point, maybe you want to get to an infrastructure that's just using the enterprise tool, then you can introduce something called team build. But this is the approach that we have. The approach is take steps.
Yes.
You don't have to do everything all at once. You can do it team by team. Like one team could be using team build, another team could be Bridge for Git plus Endevor. You can also introduce things gradually. So a pattern that I think I've seen at a number of customers is you use Bridge for Git as kind of the production build, but you know, if for unmapped branches that are not talking to something in Endevor, you use team build as a developer build.
Yes.
So the nice thing there is you have a build that you can get working without breaking your production build. And then at some point in time, if you decide that you're ready to go what we call Git native, meaning there's no hybrid anymore, everybody's just using Git and the enterprise tool orchestration, now your build's team build.
Yep.
And you've been using it for
everybody's
however many years, months with a developer build. They're comfortable, and you don't have this risk of forcing everybody to learn everything all at once.
Exactly.
And I think that's pretty unique in our portfolio. If you look at the marketplace, nobody else can do this.
No, not at all.
Yeah.
Not at all. And nor can they really show a lot of immediate value at every step along the way.
Yes, exactly. That is a good point. Let's say you are somebody in your company that wants to spearhead transformation. It's a lot easier to do when you do something small and then turn around and say, look what we did.
Yep.
Here's the value. Here's the ROI on the time.
Yes.
You can build momentum. If you go to your management and say, we're going to need to do, you know, a $2 million transformation project, that's a little harder to
do. Incredibly hard.
Yeah, and oftentimes it doesn't work for many of the reasons I just said. Then you've got a big problem, right? So,
yeah. Excellent. So that's an excellent overview. I mean, it's great to know, right? The wide swath of solutions that we offer really give you value at each step that you want to take in moving towards complete modernization, but not even that really. It's complete movement towards modern tooling, but preservation
of
everything that you already have set up and what people are used to following.
And you're really bringing the teams along when they're ready, when they want to. I don't know. I've seen enough in my organization. I've seen enough times where people are forced to do things, And people are people. If they don't like something and they're being forced to do something, they're going to find problems and they're going to make noise and they're going to, you know, whereas if you have a coalition of the willing, they find solutions for problems instead of going, ah, this is terrible, we can't do this, etc. So the key is to make sure that you're working with people who want to do what they're doing, which, and by the way, if you, nobody wants to do it and you just want to stay using ISPF and Endevor,
There's nothing wrong with that.
Nope. That, I mean, maybe we should talk a little bit about why you might want to transform.
Well, in part, that's kind of what we've been covering in the earlier episodes, looking at each little part. So kind of talking about that value you get at every step along the way. Yeah. So it's been really great to have you to provide that broader overview, though.
Because wasn't I the first episode?
Well, we didn't get budget to travel to Toronto.
Okay.
I mean,
it would have been good. We'd had our first episode and we'd have been hungover.
we were a little drowsy looking. And we would have maybe come up with a theme song as well, which you already have an idea for.
No, that's not true.
No?
Okay. What's up, Mainframe? What do you think?
What's up, Mainframe?
Yeah.
And then there's got to be some techno stuff on top.
Yeah, maybe like, boop, 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 what's up, Mainframe? Something like that.
And coffee machine at
and
the end.
And coffee machine. And Costa.
Perfect.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks, Vaughn.
Yeah, thanks you, Zach.
Thanks for joining.